Welcome to today's webinar presented by the College Music Society, the first in our regular series for the 2021 academic year. I'm Bill Pelto, Executive Director of CMS, and it's my pleasure to MC today's presentation by Dr. Susan Raeburn, entitled, When the Show Must Go On, Resilience and Renewal in an Uncertain Time. Dr. Susan Raeburn is a licensed clinical psychologist in independent practice in Oakland, California, with a special interest in working with performing artists. She has served many years as a staff psychologist at Stanford University Medical Center and at Kaiser Permanente Medical Center in Walnut Creek, California. Dr. Raeburn has published numerous peer-reviewed articles on eating disorders, addictions, and musicians' mental health. With Eric Mizell, she also co-authored the book Creative Recovery, a complete addiction treatment program that uses your natural creativity. Susan is an active participant and presenter at music industry conferences, including South by Southwest, North by Northwest, NARIS, the Future of Music Coalition, and the Experience Music Project, and with the Performing Arts Medicine Association, where she is on their editorial board of their journal, Medical Problems of Performing Artists. An amateur guitarist-singer, Susan considers one of her greatest qualifications is working with performers, something she no doubt inherited from her parents, big band leader Boyd Raeburn and jazz vocalist Ginny Powell. I see that we have more than 60 colleagues registered for this webinar from all over the US, Canada, and abroad. Today, I'm broadcasting from my basement office in Boone, North Carolina, and Dr. Raeburn is in Oakland, California. We are also recording this webinar for later viewing via the College Music Society's online archives. Susan, welcome to the CMS webinar.
Thank you, Bill. Hello, everyone. All right, let me get into my PowerPoint here. Okay, and then I'm going to stop share, right? All right.
No, not stop share. Go to slideshow.
Slideshow. All right.
Yeah.
This is my techie, Bill Pelto. All right. No, okay. All right. So, boy, how poignant can it get to be giving a webinar on resilience on the anniversary of 9/11 in the middle of a global pandemic? You couldn't make this stuff up. Anyway, so thanks for all of you for joining me today, and special thanks to the College Music Society, Gail Berenson, Linda Koki, and Bill, of course, for including me in this series, which looks like it's going to be really great. And I always like to start any talk now with a kind of moment of mindful awareness, and believe me, this is for me as much as for you guys. So I want to invite you just to settle in, take a few breaths, kind of breathing in, breathing out, just kind of landing here today as we go. So in the webinar today, I'm really hoping to give you kind of a survey wide-angle lens on this topic of individual and also organizational resilience. There are going to be plenty of research-based practical tips about how to build and improve resilience, but any one of the topics that we're going to talk about, really, we could spend a whole afternoon or at least a 30-minute webinar talking about those. So I'm going to be skipping through some stuff pretty quickly and invite you to use the resources at the end and anything that you like about today to keep looking at it on your own. And again, I want to take a moment just both individually and collectively to remember and honor all of those folks who have helped us during any times of deep fear, loss, and uncertainty. Again, here we are in the anniversary of 9/11 in the middle of a global pandemic. And we know that people all over the world under regular conditions suffer greatly. And so I want to just, you can join me in some compassion towards the people who experienced that, not just in this pandemic. And also, you know, as we'll talk about later, gratitude for those of us who are doing better than that. Okay. Just to add a little perspective, I had to throw this in about the Decameron. And, you know, many of you who probably were English lit majors knew all about the Decameron, but just like in the way most of us have heard about Arabian Nights or something, but I had never heard of it until the New York Times talked about it. And basically during the plague in Florence, Italy in 1348, Giovanni Boccaccio and a bunch of his friends started writing a bunch of stories while they were in quarantine, and it turned into the Decameron. So I think their main point is worth us remembering today. Remember that you must die. We're all going to go over that waterfall at some point, hopefully not during this period. But it leaves us remembering that we're alive and we must live. And that's where we get into the idea of being resilient as we're alive. Okay. So during this pandemic, we know that a lot of people are suffering more greatly than they had been before. The numbers of depression, anxiety, substance abuse have gone way up in other countries, not just the US. We know that those rates are higher for younger people, less educated, the essential workers that are helping us, unpaid caregivers, and ethnic minorities, and with people with pre-existing health and mental health disorders. We know that race and class disparities just continue to be starkly evident across the board. And as the Greater Good Science Center quote, that Black people are more likely to be infected, less likely to be tested and treated, and less likely to survive if they get the virus. So I think we have a collective opportunity now, and I would say responsibility, to reevaluate, redesign, and reorganize. I cannot even read my slides from my face there, but to basically reconsider all the priorities and systems that we're operating in for the greater good, that it's really a time of potential renewal. So I wanted to just start with some basics about stress and coping. Many of you are well aware of all of this, personally and professionally. And you know, when we think about stress, usually we're thinking about distress, where we're feeling the push of the demands coming in on us that are challenging us. But there's also positive arousal, ooh, stress, and all of you performers out there are very aware of the U-shaped curve, where some arousal facilitates performance, but up to a point, after that, things start coming back down. So being able to manage the stress that you experience is really important for performers and for all of us. We know that the cognitive appraisal of stress is really central to all of this. We're all saying, how bad is it? Is it a threat or a challenge? We're doing this right now in Northern California with the fires and the air quality going. The other day we had orange skies, which fortunately has calmed down. But we know that this mindset matters. Are you feeling avoidant, where you want to just hide out and go, I can't handle this? Or are you staying open, maybe hopeful, confident maybe, and say, I have what it takes to handle this, I can do it. We also know that to manage stress successfully, you're gonna need to use both emotion-focused coping, managing feelings and the bodily states that go along with that, and solving problems, you know, problem-focused coping. When the pandemic first hit, we were all running around going, you know, where's the hand sanitizer, or how do I get a mask, right? And those are important things to take action on. Okay, so levels of stress, as we know, go from mild, and now we can say catastrophic, where it's just too much and life is actually getting disrupted. And it could be because of how intense the single stressor is, but usually, especially now with the virus, it's having multiple stressors all at once, where this is impacting people's livelihoods, et cetera. And it's really compounded with people with a lot of earlier vulnerabilities, what we call sensitization. Patterns of stress, wow, look at the left-hand column, unpredictable, extreme, prolonged, often we're sensitized and feeling vulnerable. Most of us, I think, we're used to more the right-hand column, you know, and so this is really a new thing, which really requires our working with our resilience. So here's a basic definition from the American Psychological Association. That is the process of adapting well in the face of adversity, trauma, tragedy, any significant sources of stress. But we know that resilience also involves bouncing back from difficult experiences and can involve profound personal growth. So we're going to talk more about that. I want to emphasize from the beginning the systemic nature of resilience. This is from Steve Southwick, who you're going to hear me talk more about. And what he's reminding us is that healthy adaptation to stress depends not just on an individual, but on every organization and part of the system they're embedded in, all of which in themselves may be more or less resilient. I think it's safe to say right now that the impact of government leadership, federally, state, all of that really has pointed out to the importance of these parts of the system being more or less resilient. We know that resilience is not just a fixed trait that you either have it or you don't. And even positive traits that we're going to talk about, depending on the situation, they may actually be the best or not. You know, it really depends on what's happening. But we know that researchers have identified a collection described as hardiness, or sometimes described as mental grit, that goes along with a cluster of very specific personality traits and behaviors associated with high performance under stress. But basically, this comes down to staying fully engaged, staying actively engaged, having some sense of control over what's happening. We used to call that internal locus of control of reinforcement in psychology. And seeing adversity, again, as more of a challenge than a threat. The good news is that these particular behaviors can be learned and strengthened. We know that an individual's resilience is made up of a vast combination of elements, everything from genetics to obviously the conditioning related to your personal history, which we're going to talk a lot about. And researchers pretty much are saying a 50-50 contribution of genes and environment to resilience. But I do like to pay attention to authors such as Gabor Maté and Robert Sapolsky when they argue that, one, you can't really meaningfully talk about gene expression outside of the specific environment in which it's being observed. Linda Graham, who you're going to hear a lot about today, she wrote a couple of great books. She's reminding us that we know that secure attachments and what we would talk about as early entrainment to other healthy brains and well-regulated nervous systems are the best buffer against later stress and trauma. It matters if what your early life is around being around healthy, mature people with good resilience. And conversely, when people are raised with, you know, immature or destructive parenting, it's going to make it harder for people to learn to self-regulate or to calm down and think clearly. So factors negatively impacting the development of resilience, of course, include all stressful effects of early conditioning related to adverse childhood experiences, things like chronic neglect, intrusion, obviously people growing up in invalidating environments with sexism, racism, and what Isabel Wilkerson would now remind us about casteism. Any forms of trauma like that often land people in what we call insecure attachments, or when it's really bad, chaotic or disorganized attachments. Maybe they end up with self-defeating attitudes like learned helplessness, often they have harmful behavioral practices like abusing alcohol and drugs to self-medicate, resulting in dysfunctional relationships that are actually not good for your health. We're gonna talk a lot about social connection today. Having emotional and cognitive rigidity, and having real problems with self-regulation. We know that people with pre-existing conditions in any of these ways are going to require some special help, and as will people with multiple other stressors like, you know, chronic poverty, systemic racism and sexism, unsafe environments, all of that. The good news, yay, is that our brains are remaining plastic. Even older folks like us, So neuroplasticity, of course, refers to that innate capacity of the brain to be able to learn adaptive new patterns and kind of override the old harmful ones by engaging your new brain repeatedly over time. Linda Graham says it well, experience is how the brain learns, unlearns, and relearns anything ever. And we've all heard Donald Hebb's comment about neurons that fire together, wire together. I wanted to just throw this graphic in that I think all of you, I'm sure, are quite aware of these different parts of the brain. But I want to say, wow, our brains are really amazing, you know. And I stole this slide from my friend Margaret Elson, so I had to give her a little shout out. Okay, so the development of resilience, we also know there's something called a stress inoculation that coping with manageable levels of stress actually helps build resilience, kind of like being vaccinated or building muscle with exercise. So anyone can learn to see themselves as someone who can learn to cope in a better way. I wanted to, of course, because of all the musicians and educators out there, that I want to, of course, talk about this neuroplasticity in musicians studies. I'm sure many of you have already seen this, that we know that brain changes, specific brain changes in professional musicians related to their specific musical training were profound. And the more years of training were involved, the greater were the changes. It's kind of like the research on taxi drivers in London, where their brains, the part that has to do with geography and spatial learning, were looking very different than mine. Okay, so jumping into, these are from Southwick and Charney's extensive interviews of very highly resilient people. So they talk with people like Navy SEALs and Iraq war veterans, survivors, people who had faced and overcome difficulties, personal loss, whatever it was. And so they came up with these 10 common factors. You're gonna see, I'm gonna just to show you the breadth of it, several different versions of this, but you can see the commonalities. So first one was that there are these people, highly resilient people, were realistically optimistic. They weren't just pie in the sky, it was realistic. They were able to face their fear instead of avoiding things. They had some sense of direction around moral compass. They often had some connection with religion or spirituality. They had adequate social support and including resilient role models, again, that could sort of help them. They were physically fit. They kept their brain fit by staying actively engaged and learning things. They had cognitive and emotional flexibility, and they had a sense of meaning and purpose. So again, these are kind of basic themes you're gonna see repeated in as we go. So the American Psychological Association kind of put this into four core strategies of building resilience. Building connection, really important, we'll talk a lot about it. Fostering a sense of wellness, finding purpose, and embracing healthy thoughts. And many of you are familiar with the work of Dan Siegel. He has written a lot of really great stuff and is doing webinars and all that himself. So he talked about his healthy mind platter, where, and again, there's a lot of overlap. So we're gonna just go through what Dan Siegel is talking about. So he's talking about the importance of inward reflection time, where you're able to sort of cultivate attention, the idea of intentionally connecting to people in nature, spending time focusing on something external with discipline, like reading a book or practicing music, having playtime where you're laughing, can be creative and spontaneous, staying physical, moving your bodies and exercising, being able to rest and sort of good dissociation by stuff like watching a movie, and getting enough sleep. Linda Graham goes along and talks about five intelligences related to improving resilience and offers practices in each of these areas. So I'm gonna go through this with some detail. On somatic intelligence, she's talking about the importance of learning to recognize when your nervous system is in a state of high arousal or shutdown and be able to learn how to calm down. And this is the kind of stuff we talked about in therapy. We talk about in therapy about getting grounded, often through breathing exercises. I like the one about putting your hand on your heart and kind of calming down from the somatic experiencing people. The idea of taking intentional pauses to rest while you're challenged. So that's an important part. And learning to manage the old brain's negative bias. Our brains still want to head towards defense and survival as, you know, as if a bear is going to eat us. And so knowing that we tend to do that is very helpful in not having to sort of engage it as much. Emotional intelligence, of course, Dan Goleman wrote a wonderful book about this many years ago. The idea here is learning to recognize emotional states in ourselves and others. And of course, that's a basis of developing empathy. Being able to label and regulate your emotions. Dan Siegel says, name it to tame it. Being able to identify the function of emotions as they provide guidance in getting your needs met. Emotions are your ally, not an enemy. And, you know, I had so many experiences with people in my practice of, you know, men coming in, having taken their kids to see Pixar's Inside Out, which is about children and emotion. And these you know, dads would be crying in my office because they took their kid to see the movie and they got in touch with how out of touch they had been with their own emotions. And, you know, it really was an eye opener for them. So that was just priceless. I had to share that. The idea of relational intelligence within the self, and of course, this is a lot of what we do in therapy, the idea of becoming attentive or mindful to your thoughts, feelings, and behaviors, practicing self-acceptance and self-compassion. When facing challenges, continuing to feel positive states, but not suppressing negative states. We don't want, denial is not helpful, but noticing it and being able to shift your state, that's something that goes along with resilience. I love Marshall Linehan's idea of wise mind from dialectical behavior therapy, where she talks about thinking and feeling working together in an integrated way instead of being caught up in obsessive rumination or, you know, overwhelmed in your emotions. The idea of we're going for this integration. And the idea of maintaining cognitive and emotional flexibility versus getting rigid in your defenses. In the recovery programs, of course, they talk a lot about recovery toolkit and having the right tool for the job. So as they say in the 12-step programs, if all you have is a hammer, everything starts looking like a nail. Not that effective. The idea of relational intelligence with others, and here we're talking about developing authentic and secure bonds with others. This was so important that the World Health Organization described social connection as a vital sign. I did a talk on this some years ago at PAMA for the Performing Arts Medicine Association, and we know that this really has a big impact, social connection. The idea of having some reflective intelligence, and again, we're talking here often about mindfulness practice. In therapy, we used to talk about just capacity for observing ego. And now often it's described more as mentalization or meta-awareness. Even Deepak Chopra, I noticed last week on public television, has a new show called Meta-Human. So this concept, you know, has definitely landed. So we're going to talk a little bit here about mindfulness. We know it's a very well-established practice worldwide now. And as I like to suggest, I think psychology thinks it invented mindfulness instead of stealing it from Buddhism. But I have to say that secularizing a lot of the principles of mindful practice and attitudes has really been a very effective strategy. I'm sure a lot of the people, when I used to do a dialectical behavior therapy course at Kaiser Permanente for people in recovery, that they had no idea, many of them, even in the Bay Area, that they were really learning Buddhist concepts like loving kindness and gratitude and compassion. So I know Dr. Cornett had done a webinar for CMS on this back in 2016. So those of you who are into this, you might want to check that out again. We also know that mindfulness training actually helps build resilience. And many of you probably already took this 8-week mindfulness-based stress reduction class that really does help parts of your brain that deal with self-regulation and well-being. So I have to share my favorite anecdote about observation without judgment. I would say, gosh, it was probably 20 years ago that I took a Vipassana insight meditation course. And my teacher, who was great, Margaret Cullen, told us this story, which I have repeated to my people in my practice many times. So a meditation student starts speaking to a veteran monk. And he says, you've been meditating for 40 years. Does that mean you're really no longer judgmental? Okay, shout out to the monk at work. Well, when the monk stopped laughing, he just said, oh hell, I'm just as judgmental as ever. I just don't believe it anymore. So the point being, you can learn to notice and delete what I'm going to call spam coming in towards yourself or others, and just don't engage it. If you see some spam coming in on your email, you probably don't engage it and send money to whoever asked you for the money. You know, you just know it's spam and you get rid of it. So it's there, but it's gone. So all five of these intelligences work together and are integrated by the prefrontal cortex in conjunction with your older brain systems. So the goal here is to stabilize and improve your baseline resilience over time through new learning and practice in any or all of those five areas. Okay, So to kind of recap, bring some lifestyle factors into this, we know that honoring the whole self really is essential in developing, maintaining, and improving resilience. And you can do that by having adequate amounts of all of these things. Again, some overlap with already what we've talked about. The idea of the importance of exercise and movement, being able to get in the habit of moving, and some of this like dancing around your living room, but basically to make that a priority. To be able to have adequate nutrition, to be able to get enough sleep and rest, to have positive social connection. Again, a really important one. The idea here is to be in relationships that, as we say, leave the person leaving you feel seen, safe, soothed, and secure. I had to throw in this idea about the Barbra Streisand effect. And as I did, you might say, what? What is that? So this is from a lecture of Dr. John Breer, who's a brilliant guy at USC, talking about complex trauma. So he puts that out there and we all go, what's that? And he goes, oh, you know what that is? You know, people who need people. All right. Creativity and flow, important part of resilience. And I suggest, and it's in your resources, Paula Thompson and Victoria Jock's new book on creativity, trauma, and resilience. The idea of learning to be in the zone where you can be guided by intuition. We know this helps resilience. Being able to learn new things, right? Being able to take up a new instrument or in it, keeping your brain active. Having laughter and play, having fun to help activate your brain's reward system in a healthy way. So of course, this is the only joke I could really find to add to this. So this is from Bizarro talking about the four sidemen of the apocalypse. So the band leader was saying to his band, okay, this looks like the end, boys, so back me up on one last jam. Fortunately, I'm pretty sure we're gonna end up back in real live music at some point, hopefully sooner than later. The idea of having contemplative practices, and again, there's a lot out there. People are getting real research grants at places like University of California, Berkeley, now on all these positive psychology elements. Mindful awareness, again, and I always talk with clients about mindfulness skills, but mindfulness skills are definitely improved by doing a regular meditation practice. Empathy towards self and others, a sense of compassion, having gratitude in your life, and I would say all the research about making the list and all that, it really works. And continuing to make meaning in your life and living a sense of purpose. The idea of opening to transcendent experiences, and we're going to talk more about this, about awe, connecting to something greater than ourselves, really important here, okay? So awe is a very complex emotion. It's positive awe and negative awe. There's a wonderful white paper from the Greater Good Science Center. It's in your resources called The Science of Awe that I would recommend you to. And positive awe, we know, has some real potential benefits. We also, you know, it's perceived vastness. Negative awe would be things like a sense of dread or threat. If you were a person of Jewish inheritance or background in Paris when the Nazis started coming through Paris in World War II, I think it's safe to say that you would be feeling real negative awe and it would not be helping your resilience. So here's some experiences of awe. We know they're found in observing nature, observing art and beauty, music, dance, poetry, and literature. I love this idea of collective effervescence. That would be like you're either playing in an orchestra or a dance company, dancing in a company, or you're a member of the audience at a symphony performance or a rock show, where you just feel joyful in the sense of the collective in beauty. Acts of moral goodness, encouraging others. I don't know if any of you, probably many of you, watched the memorial service for John Lewis. And, you know, I know it brought a tear to my eye, but that was an example of positive awe related to his courage and moral goodness. The idea of having mystical experiences, of witnessing life and death, can't get more basic than that. So those are all important things that to cultivate in terms of your relationship with resilience. I like these three attitudes that I want to just emphasize here. One of them is the idea of practicing radical acceptance, which acknowledges legitimate pain as part of life, but reduces optional suffering. And again, this is right out of dialectical behavior therapy now. It's really about accepting the truth, whether you like it or not, or whether you agree with it or not. I think it's safe to say during COVID-19 that people who are not radically accepting our situation with the virus end up with a lot of optional suffering because they're not socially distant and they're not wearing masks and taking care of themselves. So radical acceptance, turning the mind when you notice you're not accepting it, is what DBT emphasizes. The idea of shifting your cognitive appraisal from threat into challenge again, and people like Viktor Frankl, who wrote about tragic optimism, seeking meaning in adversity, this is the kind of stuff that is involved there. Focusing on the part of a situation you can actually do something about. This is right out of the Serenity Prayer, the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, the wisdom to know the difference, a good resilience skill. So where do you go with all this stuff? And basically Southwick and Charney just say, choose one or two of these factors that just sort of fit for your lifestyle and seem doable. And then you practice the heck out of them over time, right? Linda Graham reminds us that doing small doses of new stuff repeated often incrementally actually works the best. So instead of meditating once a month for 5 hours, you know, probably wouldn't hurt you, but better to meditate 10 minutes a day and again, sort of get that new pathway in your brain going. And then over time, add more factors. So I did promise we were going to talk about post-traumatic growth for a minute. And this really refers to the transformation possible when people's core beliefs have been challenged and they end up different than they were and a positive change comes in. And Tedeschi and Calhoun came up with this in the 90s and concluded that such growth is fairly common and universal across cultures. So they researched the growth in five of these areas: appreciating life more, relating to others, finding personal strengths, recognizing new possibilities, and having a spiritual shift or deepening of their spiritual feelings. Growth didn't have to happen across the board. Even just one or two of these areas could really have a positive impact. Okay, so now we're going to go back to the resilience of systems. We know that organizations at every level impact the resilience of their members either positively or negatively. Okay, I was benefiting at the early part of the shelter in March of taking advantage of some free webinars from that the UCSF Department of Psychiatry were putting on, people like Elisa Eppel, Decker Keltner, you know, just a lot of great people, researchers in this area. And it was so striking that a lot of the frontline medical staff who were in the middle of it right there were talking about how distressed, having a sense of moral distress, outrage and injury, because they weren't getting the leadership they needed from the federal government all the way down, and that they weren't getting the protective gear they needed to really do their jobs. And they were really trying to avoid burnout or moral apathy. So as part of thinking about organizational resilience, I thought, let's just talk for a minute about cultural competence. And many of you, not only have probably taken courses in cultural competence, you might've been teaching them, but I thought, okay, it won't hurt to throw this in given everything that's happening right now. So we know that we're talking about here about the ability of a person to be able to communicate effectively and understand and be respectful to people with cultural identities and backgrounds different than their own. And this involves recognizing the intersection of race, gender, social class, age, might be immigration status. A lot of different things can be in here. I like to remind, especially you guys, to pay attention to being culturally competent about the subcultures of the performers you're working with. For musicians, genre and subculture, really it got pointed out so heavily from Diana Kinney's study a few years ago on death rates for popular musicians. If any of you haven't seen it, you should read it in MPPA journal. And what she found was that these were popular musicians, but their genre really had differences depending on, their death rates were different depending on the genre. Okay, so this is the American Psych Association talking about steps to becoming culturally competent. And, you know, nothing surprising here. to really first see yourself having the awareness about being a cultural being and having that lens, to be able to clarify your own values and to really be open to looking at your own implicit bias, prejudices, stereotypes, and you know what many of us in the white community are talking about or understanding is not expecting our diverse students or colleagues to educate us about bias, that this is really about doing our own homework about the history of this, which for me was aided greatly by the New York Times 1619 project that I think is still available out in the world. And also we have to talk about cultural responsiveness because it really, our culture is continuously changing and we need to also. Had to put this in here, talking about organizations trying to be responsive. This is from Tomasini, who's the chief classical music critic of the New York Times. And boy, this graphic really got my attention. I'm sure it does yours, that 1970, there was one full-time Black player at the New York Phil, and now in 2020, there was one. So his point here is that orchestras and then all organizations, I know in the Bay Area, everyone is talking about looking at their setup. But anyway, the things really do need to evolve in a good way that takes race and gender into account and the full spectrum of the musician's experience. Okay. Again, just straight out of the New York Times recently, that of the more than 500 students who graduate from American universities with jazz degrees each year, less than 10% are Black. And given the history of contribution from that community to jazz, I'm going, wow, this really, what's wrong with this picture? So I want to invite you to think about the aspirations for the organizations you're in, right? And this obviously College Music Society. For me, it's the Performing Arts Medical Association and your universities, your departments, you know, pretty much everywhere that you get to say, you know, where are we at? Has your mission statement changed in response to COVID-19 and the intensification of what have been longstanding racial and social justice movements? And if not, what needs to happen to move it in the direction of what we can call post-traumatic growth? Okay, how can this become more of a challenge than a threat? Okay, so I'm gonna end there. Here are some resources. I hope you'll check these out. There are plenty others across the country in major psychiatry departments and medical centers. So I just picked the ones close to me. Three books I would highly recommend. And then some websites about organizational resilience. And I wanna end today with this poem from Clarissa Pinkola Estes. All right, another time for a mindful breath here. Okay. She says, refuse to fall down. If you cannot refuse to fall down, refuse to stay down. You may be pushed down, but no one can keep you from lifting your heart towards heaven. So good to remember. All right, thanks again to everybody, to the College Music Society for inviting me today. And I think it's safe to say that the show is going to go on. When, we don't know, but I'm really want to stay in, this is a challenge, not a threat. Okay, everybody, thank you so much for your attention today. All right.
Thanks, Susan.
Okay.
Terrific stuff. And I want to start by just drawing attention. There was a question in the chat about, will this be available online again? Yes, we will be putting this up in the CMS library probably early next week. And so I know that you had a lot of resources that people will want to consult, and just all of Susan's presentation will be there probably by Tuesday, just depending on how quick we can get it through our editing process. And so just scroll through it and you can find those resources, and encourage your colleagues to do the same. But Susan, thanks. Boy, you raised so many interesting things. I'm sure there's some questions from our attendees, and as they come up, I'll make sure we ask them. But I wanted to start, if you could refer to, I had a whole bunch of questions. The first was, you mentioned a class in mindfulness stress reduction. And actually, I had not heard of that, so probably some of our other attendees had not. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, I'm happy to. You know, my generation of therapists came out of behavioral medicine doing stuff like stress management, where we did progressive muscle relaxation. But Jon Kabat-Zinn at University of Mass General Hospital did a program that basically started popularizing mindfulness training, like many people like Jack Kornfield, you know, a lot of people who had been drawn towards studying Buddhism in Asia became psychologists and came back here. So Jon Kabat-Zinn developed a program for Mass General for people who had like anxiety disorders and just in medical problems, where it was an 8-week course on learning mindfulness and included some yoga, but very what's called Vipassana or insight meditation. So it's very cognitive, like how are you thinking, you know, so I like that was my preference. So anyway, that course has evolved over many years. Kaiser Permanente offers it. And it's now called mindfulness-based stress reduction. So it's widely available, you know, in a lot of places now. It's like an 8-week course, and I highly recommend it. It's a great way to launch a meditation practice.
Is there an online version?
I would be very surprised if there's not a whole bunch of online versions of it at this point. Yeah, you know, yeah. All you'd have to do is Google mindfulness-based stress reduction and, you know, or just go to Jon Kabat-Zinn. So
great, thanks. And let's see, it looks like we've got a question in the Q&A. What was the book author of the music genre book you mentioned?
I think that was probably referring to Paula Thompson's new book with Victoria Jacques. Paula is a professor and a former dancer and kinesiologist at Cal State Northridge. But member PAMA, who I had the benefit of doing a panel with on actors at PAMA UCLA last year. Anyway, this book just came out in July. She and Victoria Jacques did a previous book. This one really talks about creativity, deep study, you know, it's an academic sort of resource book, and creativity and trauma and resilience and trying to integrate those fields. Really a major accomplishment, I think.
Terrific. Great, thanks. I noticed some parallels between some of the resilience factors you were talking about and the popular book that my family knows called Blue Zones by Dan Buettner. Do you know of that?
No,
I
don't know.
Yeah, it's a geographical look at resilient populations and actually about longevity. But, you know, some of those same factors.
It all fits together.
It sure does. Yeah, I mean, walking, growing things, so that's that kind of practice that you're talking about. You know, for musicians, I think there's the obvious connection with the things we do that actually encourage mindfulness on a daily basis, just because of practice.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's great. And you also talked about Isabel Wilkerson, who's we've read her book. I always get the
first
title
book.
Yes, the one about a warmth of other suns. Is that right? Yes.
Yeah.
This is her new book about casteism in the world, right?
Pretty powerful.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, some of you might have heard her interview with Terry Gross on Fresh Air too, that she talks about even how caste has been coming in with the Nazis, since my Nazi reference, that's probably where that came from, looking at early experiences of the eugenics movement in the United States pre-World War II. So there's a lot of disturbing and, you know, history in there that's good to know about, to stay out of denial about.
Yeah. And then just before we close this officially, which we should do now, I guess. I'm curious, Susan, if you have projects that you're working on currently that we should be watching for, if you've got anything out that we should pay attention to?
Thanks for asking. I'll try to not have my anxiety go up when I answer that.
Okay.
Now that this webinar is done, you know, I can relax about that at least, I hope.
Right, sure.
I was actually supposed to go do a panel with other PAMA members in New Orleans, of course, in June. That never happened. So I'm hoping to use some of what I was doing today next year in PAMA New York. We'll see. Hopefully we'll be able to travel by then. But in the meantime, I'm now working on a couple of book chapters for a book out of London that's going to be talking about touring and mental health. And of course, this book was already in the works before COVID, everything came to a screaming halt for musicians touring. But I'm going to do a chapter on stress and that, having, you know, way back in my dissertation research on occupational stress with popular musicians. I think that came out in MPPA, my first journal article in 87, back ancient history. Mm-hmm. And then also a chap on addiction that I'm going to do for that book, assuming that project goes. So I need to practice my own seeing those pressures as a challenge, not a threat, basically.
live your own talk, right?
And get to work, you know, basically.
Yeah, well, thanks, Susan. I guess I do need to wrap this up officially. So to those who've been listening today, I hope you've enjoyed this College Music Society webinar and that you've found it professionally informative. In the next days, webinar attendees should receive email confirmation of your attendance. Please feel free to use the comment option in that email to provide feedback about this series and our format. I hope you'll return for our next webinars from the College Music Society, including next Friday's focus on opportunities for presenting scholarly work in our journals and books and monograph series, as well as our regional, national, and international conferences. And our next Musicians Health webinar will occur on Friday, November 13th. And now, on behalf of all of us at the College Music Society, I want to thank Susan Raeburn for her presentation and all of our listeners for attending. Please accept our best wishes for today and the upcoming weekend. I hope to see you back here next week and in November.